Greetings, everyone. Welcome to this amazing event that's a collaboration with IAIA's MFA program and the Coe Center. We're really excited about it. Thank you so much for coming. I'm Rachel Wixom. I'm the executive director here at the Coe Center. The Coe Center is about connecting, experiencing, and engaging with and learning from each other with the world's indigenous arts as the catalyst. We have about 2,500 pieces here at the collection. If you haven't come to visit us, I hope you come sometime and spend some time in the collection and we can teach each other about it all. Oh, it's wonderful to see so many familiar faces. I'm not going to speak very long. You're not here to hear me. So I want to turn it over to Mario and Dawn, Mario from IAIA and Dawn as well. I'll let them introduce themselves. And again, thank you so much for being part of this event.
Hi, everyone. My name is Mario Caro. I am the director of the MFA in Studio Arts at the Institute of American Indian Arts. I am so delighted to be at the Coe Center being hosted here. We're collaborating on this and hope to continue to collaborate on other programming. I just want to welcome everyone and thank you for joining us for this conversation that I am sure will be not only stimulating, but I think it's going to be incredibly provocative in terms of this exhibition that I think is going to have a long-lasting effects, not just at the University of Hawaii at Mānoa, where it's being hosted, but also just throughout academia and beyond, because it's a really interesting situation, and I'm not going to describe much, and I'll let our guests do that for themselves. But I did want to express gratitude for the incredible agility of all of the participants to come together. This took shape over it feels like just a couple of weeks. So I'm very grateful for everyone making time to do this. I also want to take a moment to acknowledge the place we're broadcasting from, at least the few of us that are here at, in Ogopogo, which is the indigenous name for Santa Fe, New Mexico. This is the traditional homeland of 19 pueblos, what is now called New Mexico. Is a very vibrant region with many communities that are, on a daily basis, exercising their sovereignty over their land and their culture. Also acknowledge that this is home to Diné folks as well as Apache folks. I wanted to do, my own acknowledgement and want to stress that this is not an institutional one. The various institutions that I traverse always have their own kind of formulaic and somewhat, sometimes benign land acknowledgement. But I need to place myself here as someone who has migrated north from the south. It's an involuntary migration. So my place here and my trajectory here is informed by that experience. So I want to express gratitude to Rachel Wixom, the director of the Coe Center, Alex Pina, who is the deputy director and chief curator at Coe. And I also want to introduce and thank my other half of the MFA, Dawn Double Blaze, who is the program coordinator, and she makes everything happen, really. And finally, I want to introduce Heidi, who's going to introduce the panel. Heidi Brandow, I've had the pleasure of working with for a couple of years, but I think it's more like a year and a half, where when she joined us as a guest speaker last year, and now is one of our faculty members. Heidi's work as an artist and as a mentor, in terms of her pedagogy, has been exemplary for us. And I'm so happy that she's able to help us moderate this program. So Heidi, I'll let you take it away and introduce yourself more properly and the rest of our panel.
Great, thank you so much, Mario. Velina mai ke aloha e nā pula pula. Mai moana nui a kea a hiki I keia aina o nā Maoli I Santa Fe. O vau no o Heidi ke haulani Brandow, he papa Hawai'i a me hapa Diné vau. No hilo mai au, ua hānai I a vau I ka moko o Keawe a me New Mexico. No la ie mai o Kuʻumākua Hine, o ano Coyote Canyon mai o Kuʻumākua Kane. Mahalo piha loa no ko ka ko o ana mai. Ya te she'e Heidi Brandow Yunichia, Hawaiian Ishneto, Torichi Nibashishin, Hawaiian E, Dasha Cheido, Nashkali Dasha Nali. Hello everyone, welcome. We're so excited to have everyone here. My name is Heidi Brandow. I'm the guest curator and artist liaison at the Co, as well as an artist mentor, as Mario had mentioned, at the IAIA MFA Studio Arts Program. I am Diné and Kanaka Maoli, and I currently reside in Santa Fe, New Mexico. So just to give a little bit of sort of background or a little bit of background, I guess, on this presentation today, which we're all really excited to have the participants here to speak with everyone. I first learned about the Ai Pōhaku exhibition through various posts on Twitter. The mission, artwork, and exhibition title, Ai Pōhaku, or Stone Eaters, immediately reminded me of my childhood at Keaukaha Elementary School in Hilo on the Big Island. Shout out to Keaukaha, where in 1993, the centennial anniversary of the illegal overthrow, which was also the centennial anniversary of the illegal overthrow, we were immersed in learning the history, mele, and hula associated with the overthrow of the Hawaiian kingdom. The mele or song, kaulana nā pua, or famous are the flowers or children, or mele ai pōhaku, the stone eating song, captures the cultural, political, and religious pain of the overthrow and is pointedly expressed in the lyrics, which our guests will elaborate on during this presentation. This poetic mele, or music, embraces onipa'a, or steadfast, as a commitment to Hawaiian sovereignty as it reinforces the demands of Kanaka Maoli for the restitution of lost lands while expressing the sociological themes of a dispossessed society. These issues and demands continue to inform Kanaka Maoli artists and culture bearers. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our panelists joining us today from Hawai'i. Broderick is an artist, curator, and educator from Mokapu, a peninsula currently occupied by the US military. Raised in a deep-rooted matriarchy on the windward side of Oahu, his work is guided by the long-standing and ongoing efforts of Kanaka ʻŌiwi women, especially his mother, aunties, and maternal grandmother, who have devoted their lives to art, education, organizing, and community building in Hawai'i. Currently, Drew serves as director of Koa Gallery, Papi'olani College, and as a member of Kekahi Wahi, a film collective documenting stories of transformation across Moana Nui. Recently, Drew co-curated Hawai'i Triennial 2022 Pacific Century, E Ho'omau no Moana Nui Akea, credited the publication Contact, and completed an MA from the Center of Curatorial Studies at Bard College. Our next guest, Noelle Kahanu. Noelle was born and raised and educated in Honolulu, Hawai'i. From 1992 to 97, she served as counsel to the US Senate Committee on Indian Affairs, where she worked on issues affecting Native Hawaiians, American Indians, and Alaska Natives. From 1998 to 2014, Noelle worked at Bishop Museum, holding various positions, including cultural inventory specialist, project manager, and director of community affairs. She has overseen numerous programs and developed over 20 exhibitions featuring the works of more than 100 Native artists. She was a member of the project team for the renovations of Hawaiian Hall and Pacific Hall, and was instrumental in the landmark exhibition E Kū Anaka Paia, an international gathering of the last three Kū temple images in the world. One of the projects she is most proud of is the documentary Under a Jarvis Moon, which tells the story of her grandfather and other young Hawaiian men who colonized the Line Islands in the 1930s. In 2014, Noelle joined the American Studies Department at the University of Hawai'i at Mānoa as a Pacific Humanities Hawaiian Program Specialist. Our next guest is Josh Tengan. Josh is a curator, cultural producer, and arts administrator from Pauoa Oahu, Hawaii. He is a generational islander of Kanaka ʻŌiwi, Ryu, Kiwan, and Madeiran descent. His curatorial practice centers on art of Hawaii and Moana Nui Akea. Tengan currently serves as associate director of Hawaii Contemporary, the nonprofit arts organization that presents the Hawaii Triennial, as well as Pu'uhonua Society, one of Hawaii's longest standing arts organizations. Current curatorial projects include Ai Pōhaku, Stone Eaters, an intergenerational exhibition of 40 Native Hawaiian artists. And he was the assistant curator of the second Honolulu Biennial in 2019. Josh is also a lauhala weaver and alakai with Kiana Hala, and a weaving hui centered on revitalizing practices around traditional Hawaiian moana. He has studied lauhala under various kumu, including Mahina and Cheryl Pukahi, Auntie Lorna Pacheco, and Auntie Dee Shimabukuro. Our artists that have joined us today include Kaili Chun, a sculptor and installation artist who uses processes and materials that transform physical spaces into unique environments that comment on contemporary issues. Chun's diverse training includes receiving her bachelor's in architecture from Princeton University, during which time she also studied with renowned ceramicist Toshiko Takaezu. Kaili holds a master's from an MFA from UH Mānoa, and has had an apprenticeship with master canoe builder and woodworker Wright Bowman Sr. Kaili has received significant visual arts awards, most recently been commissioned to create an installation for the 10th Asia Pacific Triennial for Contemporary Art at the Queensland Art Gallery. And our second artist guest today is Kapulani Landgraf. Kapulani is from Pu'ahu'ula Kane'ohe Oahu. She received a BA in anthropology from the University of Hawaii, Mānoa, and her MFA in photography from Vermont College. Kapulani received a 2013 Visual Arts Fellowship from the Native Arts and Cultures Foundation and the 2014 Joan Mitchell Painters and Sculptors Grant. Landgraf's books, Na Wahipana o Ko'olau Poko and Na Wahikapu o Maui, received Ka Palapala Po'okela Awards for Excellence in Illustrative Books in 95 and 2004, respectively. She is an Associate Professor of Art at Kapi'olani College, Kalahu, Hawaii, but is currently a Title III Project Director. Without further ado, I would like to hand over the presentation to our guest today. So here we are.
Mahalo for that introduction, Heidi. And really, really wonderful to be here with you folks now. with Noelle, with Josh, with Kaili, with Kapu, to share a bit about the work that we're doing at the moment here in Hawaii, but also a bit about the work that has been done for many, many years in support of contemporary art and Hawaiian culture, both within higher education and, I think, most importantly for us, within community. We'll start by providing a bit of, historical context. Then we'll get into a more recent history of the places that we're engaging through the exhibition, and then speak about the first kind of installation of the larger project. And then we'll hear from Kaili and Kapu, who will both share a bit about their work in the show. Maybe we can go to the next slide, please. And one more. Thank you. Always good to begin with acknowledging all of the people that are in the room. These are some of those people. This is at the University of Hawaii at Mānoa, kind of in the center of the current installation. But, you know, as I was saying earlier, there's so much work that has been done by generations above us, and I'm speaking for Josh and myself now. A lot of that work has been done by Kapu and Kaili and Noel, and so it only feels right to sort of begin the conversation today by acknowledging all of the folks that are in the room with us and have been a part of laying the foundation for the work that we're doing today. Can go to the next slide, and Josh will, these are all the participating artists, just to give you folks a sense of the scale. Pōhaku is inclusive of around 40 artists and their collaborators. It's going to take place at 6 different venues over the next 8 months. The first venue opened at the end of January, and the second venue opened last week. This gives you a sense of the kind of scale and timeline. We'll talk more about the venues later on, but I think what's important for us to share now is that these are all spaces within the University of Hawaii system. So we're really talking about an educational environment that has not really been doing, in our, you know, from my perspective, what it could be doing to support our art and our stories of art. So Pōhaku is sort of intervening into that space in order to offer alternative directions onward. And that sort of remains to be seen whether or not that will happen, but we're hopeful, I suppose, if you believe in hope. We can go to the next slide and then the one after. Good to acknowledge the partners who have supported the exhibition, as well as the artists that are in the exhibition. Institute of Museum and Library Services, Native Arts and Cultures Foundation, Independent Curators International, and the Hawaii State Foundation on Culture and the Arts. None of what we're doing now would look like what it looks like now without the support of these organizations. It would look like something else, which maybe would be more interesting in the sense that we'd have to really get creative about how to support artists and the production of new work. But, you know, we're grateful for the support of these organizations and especially for Pu'uhonua Society, which Josh can share a bit about later, the nonprofit entity that's helping to lead the effort. Okay, now that we've gotten through those kind of introductory remarks about venues, artists, and partners, Josh is going to provide a bit of historical context, and Noelle and I can jump in as we make our way from the late 1800s to the early 2000s. You can go to the next slide.
Mahalo. Yeah, as Heidi mentioned earlier, Pōhaku Stone Eaters takes its name from the Hawaiian national song known today as Kaulana Napua, which literally translates to famous are the flowers. But the song is also known as Mele Pōhaku, or the Stone Eating Song. And this song was written just a few weeks after the overthrow on January 17th, 1893. when the Kingdom of Hawaii was overthrown in an armed coup d'etat by a group of white pro-American businessmen, many of whom were citizens of the kingdom, with the support and the backing of 162 U.S. Marines. But Kaulana Napua was a statement of rebellion against the new provisional government. For me, this song was punk. It was a song of resistance, and it was a statement of support for our queen, the Hawaiian kingdom, and our own sovereignty and self-determination as people. After the overthrow, when the provisional government issued a mandate for government workers to sign a loyalty oath, many officials and persons from across the kingdom resisted this order. And the most famous of whom were members of the Royal Hawaiian Band, who are integral to the story of this song. Mele'ai Pōhaku began appearing in Hawaiian language newspaper just weeks after the overthrow. Here we have one of the first printings in Nupepa from Kaleokala Hui on February 24th, 1893. You can go to the next slide. Because of a high demand from readership at the time, the song was republished multiple times. You can go to the next slide too. So here we even have this kind of quote. As a result of the many requests we received to reprint the Mele of the Patriots, we're fulfilling your desire. And this is a total accurate copy of this Mele composed from the, gotten from the lady who composed the Mele. So we know the composer of this song was Ellen Kekoʻauhiwai Kalani Wright Prendergast. I think you can go to the next slide too. Sorry, one more. So this is Eleanor Kekoʻauhiwai Kalani Wright Prendergast. We know that she was a close confidant to the queen and served as a lady in waiting. She was also recognized as a accomplished haku mele, a poet or a songwriter, having composed a handful of other nationalist songs, as well as a name chant for Liliʻu. One of Ellen's daughters in an oral history account recounted the events that occurred on the day that her mother wrote Kaulana Napua. Quote, she was sitting on an afternoon in January 1893 in the lovely garden of her father's mansion, Puahaulani Hale at Kapa'alama. Her prized guitar lay close at hand, and when guests were announced, their familiar faces proved to be the troubled ones of all but two members of the Royal Hawaiian Band on strike. We will not follow this government, this new government, they asserted. We will be loyal to Liliʻu. We will not sign the Haole's paper, but will be satisfied with all that is left to us, the stones, the mystic food of our native land. So they begged her to compose a song of rebellion. In the account by Prendergast's daughter, she mentions that were two members who refused to sign. From Nupepa article, we know that one of the members was the bandmaster himself, Henry Berger, who discouraged the band members' act of protest and told them that they would be eating rocks as if they didn't sign the oath. So kind of reflecting on this a little, kind of Prendergast took this somewhat offhanded sort of cautionary comment from Berger and turned it into this kind of profound statement saying, yes, we will eat the stones. We will proudly eat stones because that is what sustains us. Over the last century or so, Kaulana Napua has been widely sung, widely performed by many Hawaiian musicians across the island. The song has become a sort of rallying cry at protests, at gatherings, at events, at community events. So yeah, we can go to the next slide actually. Apologies. This is the Royal Hawaiian Band on the steps of Iwalani Palace in 1887 with Bandmaster Henry Berger up at the front. Okay, we can go to the next slide as well.
Josh, can I just jump in to add a little bit to what you were sharing?
Yes, sure.
Josh is sort of speaking to the ways in which Mele'ai Pōhaku is a song of resistance, a patriotic song. For us, it's also a song of affirmation. In saying no to one thing, we're also saying yes to another. And that was a sort of really important moment of understanding for all of us when we were making the exhibition, that the exhibition wasn't just a reaction to something that has happened, but mm-hmm. it begins first by affirming our work as Hawaiian artists. It begins first by affirming the work of Hawaiian artists that have come before us. And it begins first by affirming the work of Hawaiian artists that will come after us. So Mele'ai Pōhaku really became a sort of through line across the different exhibitions and a way for us to affirm our beliefs while also offering a kind of critical intervention into the educational environment that the show is being presented. Noelle, do you want to add anything to the discussion of Mele'ai Pōhaku before we talk about the exhibition histories?
You know, thank you. You know, one way to think about it is the way in which the writing community, the musicians and their community, and here now the visual arts, that there is this sort of seamless connection. And I think that oftentimes we end up in siloed places. There was a time in the 70s and 80s where there was so much connectivity between these different communities, right? Visual arts, performing arts, mele. And so I also kind of almost see it as a pathway forward for us to reconnect communities that have not been linked together strongly. In other words, sort of, what are the ways this exhibition can serve to heal fractures for us as a community as well?
Kapulani, Kaili, you want to offer anything in response to the title, or we keep moving? Okay. So now that Josh has shared a little bit of the kind of historical context that the exhibition is referencing through the name that it was given or that it carries, we also wanted to provide just a really, really quick kind of exhibition history of the last time a large-scale exhibition of contemporary Hawaiian art was presented within the University of Hawai'i system. Just to give you folks a sort of sense of where we've been, but also where we're at. So it's been 23 years since the last large-scale exhibition of contemporary Hawaiian art was supported by the University of Hawai'i. We're looking at an image now of that exhibition. Mainaku Punamai and then Hoihoi Inapu Olo was a two-part exhibition. It took place at the main gallery in Mānoa and then also at the East-West Center. And it was the first time that something like that had happened within that environment. And it was also the last time. And as we look across different institutions here in Hawaii, specifically on Oahu, we see this kind of trend. In the early 00s, right around the turn of the 21st century, museums and educational institutions supported their first exhibitions of contemporary Hawaiian art, which also, as time has proven, were their last. So for us, revisiting this venue is sort of picking up where the folks who organized the exhibition in 2000 left off. And along the way, we often ask ourselves why it's taken so long, and why, or and when it will happen again, and how maybe the measure of change is how quickly it happens after this iteration, hopefully sooner than 20 plus years. I believe, Kapu, you took this installation view, yeah? So a lot of the artists who are in the current exhibition, Aipohaku, are also a part of Mainakupunamai, Hoihoi Inapuolo, and other exhibitions that took place around the same time, including Namakaho, which was at the Honolulu Museum of Art, Ho'ikowai, which was at East West Center, and a few years before those, Ho'okue, which was also at the East West Center, that Karen, who I believe is with us today, was a part of organizing alongside April Drexel and Kimo Cashman. So, you know, it's important to just have a kind of superficial understand or surface level understanding of our exhibition histories here in Hawaii before we speak in more detail about Aipohaku. It's been a long time coming, and hopefully it doesn't take as long to do the next one. We can go to the next slide. Okay, here we are. Josh or Noel, you wanna take us in or? Okay, I'll keep talking then. As many of us who have gone through westernized higher education systems know, these spaces are designed to do things, and the things that they're designed to do often have nothing to do with supporting us. So, you know, it's a similar situation at the University of Hawaii Mānoa, especially within the Department of Art and Art History. They currently have no tenure or tenure track professors with Kanaka ʻŌiwi or Kanaka Maoli ancestry. They have one professor who is from Hawaii, and the rest of the department does not have meaningful relationships to this place. So there's a lot of work that has to be done by the students, by the staff, by the faculty, by administration to address the absences that have persisted within this department for the past 50 years, really. We're sort of looking at the intro wall text here, which is in Olala Hawaii and English, and kind of moving into the space, we see that hit of yellow on the top of a kind of umbilical cord like plinth that is carrying forms by artists across different generations in a variety of materials. But the whole exhibition is sort of laid out around a center space, and it kind of unfolds in concentric circles that spread outward from the center of the room. There are lots of long views across the gallery. There are lots of, as a viewer, one often finds themselves between works of art, not so much looking at them, but surrounded by them. And I think that the exhibition design for us is really about stressing the relationality, not between the objects, but between the makers of these things, and helping to kind of bring forward those relationships through the materials, but really across the generations and communities that the artists are a part of. We can go to the next slide. So we're moving a little bit further into the space. It's kind of opening up. We're seeing work by Bernice Akamine, Keith Tallett, Hanale Hopfi, Kahi Ching, Carlton Kupa'ahi, Pam Barton, Bob Freitas, Sean Brown, Uncle Maikalani Kalahele, Kunani Wutin, Kaili Chan, Maika'i Tubbs. There are a lot of voices in the room, and it really is a kind of celebration of sorts. Noelle and Josh, you want to? Yeah.
Yeah, actually, you know, and I think Mario kind of mentioned this maybe in the beginning, but it's the idea, sort of the unusual nature of this. And I do want to just say, and I want to read a little bit, a brief quote from the intro text. Pōhaku, Stone Eaters addresses this exclusion of Kanaka worldviews from academia and an overall lack of institutional support for Kanaka art across the islands. By advocating for Kanaka artists and culture bearers, this exhibition offers an audience an opportunity to form meaningful connections to our diverse work while ensuring that our stories of art are sustained in our ancestral homelands and abroad. So I do think it's like taking it, the exhibition takes it to the heart of the matter, which is to address exclusion and absence by being present in a space that has been so profoundly exclusive in the many ways that you've said. And you know, and you know, what I think it's done is forced a conversation within art, the art and art history department. And it's a conversation that's been really embraced by many of the students within that department and the broader UH. So I just, you know, one of the things that has been welcoming is this opportunity to take curator, to have curator led tours with many, many classes, particularly the art department, but also some a lot of American studies classes. And just to sit in conversation, and we'll get to that later about the importance of the living room. But I think there's something to be said for just being hit with that information in the intro text. And then kind of the lack of labels in the rest of the space. Which maybe we can talk about later too.
Thanks. Yeah, let's definitely get into that later. Noelle, Josh, and I all have different perspectives on wall labels. We love to talk about our differences. At the top of the wall, you folks sort of hopefully can make out this string of text. That those are the lyrics from Kaulananapua, from Meleʻai Pōhaku. So, you know, as Noelle is saying, when someone arrives at the space, they're sort of confronted or asked to confront their own relationship to the art and art history department through the absence of Kanaka artists and Kanaka stories of art within the department. And then once you enter the space, you're sort of embraced by those lyrics, which run along the top of the gallery across the entire room, and then kind of begin to develop different relationships to the work that's on view. We can go to the next slide. Just a more detailed view of the shared plinth and the absence of corresponding labels. We see Kaili Chun's work in the back, the suspended Pōhaku, next to a painting by Uncle Imai. Too much to talk about here. So we'll keep moving and focus more on a kind of conversation of the exhibition as a whole before hearing from Kaili and Kapu about their respective work in the show. We can go to the next slide. So this is sort of giving you a sense of what Noelle was speaking about earlier. The entire exhibition is revolves around a domestic space, a living room, much like we might find at our grandma's or aunties. It's a space for conversation. In this case, a space for difficult conversations, but for conversations that need to be had and should have been had much sooner. So, you know, in sort of making those conversations public, right? We're not speaking behind closed doors or speaking in the car on the way home from an event. We're speaking face to face in the place that we are offering criticisms of. And we're also speaking face to face in the place to celebrate our art and the artists that were that are part of our communities who have been excluded from this space for decades. Josh and Noelle, do you want to comment on
the
living room?
Yeah, I think we knew that gathering was really important to this exhibition. So really centralizing that, I think. Also, as a non-UH person, I have never spent so much time at UH. I think, this exhibition has really required a lot from us as curators to be present a lot and to give tours. So we do tours every Friday at 1 p.m., as well as Sundays at 1 p.m., and we lead artist talks and conversations on Sundays as well. But having to be at UH a lot, but having this space to sit in and to gather and to talk with students in a comfortable setting, in a setting that feels familiar, with furniture that you would see in, your auntie's house or something. To have the foundation of a lauhala mat that was woven in Hawai'i, with Hawaiian lauhala, with a community dedicated to revitalizing these practices was really important. And then at the center of the space, what you see is an alaya stone. So maybe we can go to the next slide, I think. Anyways, the alaya stone at the center of this space was a piece by Ipo and Kunani Nihipali, who live now on Molokai, but who have been very kind of instrumental in kind of early Hawaiian contemporary art movements of the 60s and 70s. So they wanted to basically present this alaya stone, which alaya is this kind of like red dirt, red earth stone that had a lot of medicinal and la'au lapa'au or medicinal qualities, and was used medicinally, topically on skin. It was also ingested because it was high in iron. But we really wanted to centralize this idea of healing, which could only happen through conversation and gathering face to face, healoa healo. Around the alaya stone is paakai or salt from five Hawaiian islands, which represent where all of the artists come from, all of these islands. And over time, the stone sheds its dust and kind of intermixes and mingles with the salt. And the intention of Ipo and Kunani was to gift this salt mixed with the alaya a way to and to artists and to community members. Maybe we can go to the next slide. So yeah, really foregrounding this idea that healing happens through face-to-face gathering and conversation, as Drew mentioned.
And I've definitely seen it. I've seen tears. I've seen difficult conversations. I mean, living rooms aren't all about laughter and joy. It's also the hard stuff that comes up. And I think what's important is the notion of just safety, that we've created what essentially is like a kipuka, a little safe zone in the middle of what is often perceived as a hostile environment, the University of Hawaii. And we constantly remind people, this is your gallery, this is your space. If you wanna come stop by between classes, come sit in the living room. The intentionality of it too, it's not just random furniture, it's actually Josh's great-grandmother's furniture, some of the pieces in here. And just the notion that, you know, everything is lovingly selected and there's a purpose and meaning behind everything. And there's so many ways in which that those through lines connect, how the pieces relate to one another, reflect how the artists relate to one another, the sense of community, I think really manifests itself in a very strong way within the show.
Yeah, I think to add to that, Noelle, the living room also shows us what our relationship to this place is, what our relationship to Hawaiian culture is, through something as simple as whether or not somebody takes their shoes off before they step onto the mat. So it's a place for gathering, but it's also a place for demonstrating relationship, whether that's through conversation or through where you sit, or through who you let sit first. You know, all of the kind of choreography that goes into being in a space in a way that demonstrates cultural knowledge. The living room space is surrounded by work by four different artists. Herman P. Ikea Clark, whose work we see on the far left on the black wall, chiefly regalia with kind of overlay of motifs. And then we see Maika'i Tubbs' work on the far right. We can't see it in this shot, but Kapulani Landgraf also has a piece that surrounds the center space, as does Maile Andrade. And for us, having their work in the center of the room surrounding the living room was really important because of the work that they've done within the University of Hawai'i system. These are all students of the university, but also educators within, and for some of them, administrators. Piakea's relationship to the department, I think, helps offer a kind of, what's the right word? Offer, or it reveals a lot about what the Art and Art History Department believes. Piakea wrote and offered the first course taught by a Hawaiian about contemporary Hawaiian art. And that was in 1998. That course didn't last long, and it hasn't been offered in that department for over 20 years. So in that regard, you know, we talk about the change that we're witnessing and that being a part of, but we also have to acknowledge that a lot of change hasn't happened. In fact, in some cases, the department is maybe in a worse position now than it was then, just in terms of representation. We can go to the next slide. Just a quick time check. It's 9:50. Maybe I'll stop talking and we can hear from Kapu and Kaili. Next slide, please.
Thanks. Yeah, we can next this one too. Oh, this is the Alaya stone we talked about. Come on, next.
Kahi Ching's Umeke Lao on the rooftop of the gallery. Next slide. Again, kind of circles within circles within circles.
Yeah, this is
outside.
Yeah. Directly above the gallery space. This is essentially the roof. So another kind of circle. Next. Oh, maybe we should talk about Kahi Ching briefly. So I'll talk about Kahi and you guys can jump in if you'd like. Kahi Ching is a beloved artist of working in many media, cross media. Drawing, painting, sculpture, works in wood, stone, metal, everything you can think of. But here he is working in, working with plants, working with la'au. So Kahi is also a classically trained bonsai artist, but he'll always remind me that it's not bonsai because he doesn't have his certification. So it's what Kahi has kind of come up with is this idea of what he calls umeke la'au. So umeke meaning bowl, calabash, vessel, la'au, plant or tree. and so if we could go to the previous slide, Kahi has presented a selection of 8 umeke la'au, which sit on the rooftop. And these are all plants that he has cared for, have inherited, have received. All these plants have found their way to him,
and he has cared for them and made these beautiful sort of bonsai referenced forms. Each story has a particular particular significance to him. And so, yeah, I think with that, we can jump to Papu and Kaili. Go next. Yeah, we can keep jumping forward. Yeah. Oh, okay. Kaili, would you like to share a bit about your work?
Aloha. Thank you so much again for this opportunity to converse with you folks. I'm just very grateful to Drew and Noelle and Josh for their care and their time and their effort and energy and spirit that they put into each and every one of these exhibitions that are tied into the ʻŌiwi exhibition. We just recently opened the Koa Gallery venue with ʻŌiwi, and so it's really interesting to see how they are each conversing with each other in terms of the spaces and the works, you know, between each space. And you know, before I get into my particular piece here, it's really interesting jumping back to Drew's introduction about, you know, the University of Hawaii system and its lack of support for indigenous culture and artists. It's also very interesting, you know, the art department itself, it was established in the 1950s, I believe. So it's been, let's say, 73 years. And throughout those 73 years, we have had one tenured Native Hawaiian professor and one tenure track Native Hawaiian professor. So two in 73 years. And what also is very interesting is that there is currently one tenure track professor who the rest of the department thinks is Hawaiian, but is not Hawaiian. And so, you know, we see one exclusion in the past 73 years, and now we see, quote unquote, an attempt at inclusion by either someone who is falsely identifying as Hawaiian, and that brings all kinds of problems into the situation, or you have ignorance continuing along the same line where the rest of the department, obviously not Native Hawaiian, from elsewhere, who either their ignorance is either chosen or I don't know how else to describe that, because you know, the lack of knowledge about who they have recently hired and the way that, you know, they identify themselves is to me a continuation of a greater systemic problem and practice that has been a tradition of the University of Hawaii art department. And again, you know, there are other departments within the system that are head and shoulders above the art department. One would think it would be the opposite, but that is not the case. So this piece was created in celebration of and in recognition of the song itself, you know. So I'm familiar with it as Kaulana Napua, And it is referring to, obviously, the stones are good enough for us, meaning that we will eat the stones before we sign the papers for annexation. And these stones actually come from Kapa'a Quarry. And this is one of several quarries throughout Hawaii that have been used to create all the concrete and cement that are used in construction and building the buildings found here in Hawaii. So this size of stone is the first grade of gravel, and it's called surge. And these, you know, the basalt, they're basalt stones. They come from larger boulders that have been dynamited out of the land. And it is a very kind of interesting process that's used. We don't really think of a concrete, or we don't really think of these stones as being a part of the built environment, the urban environment. And one thing about them is that, you know, they're a lot older than we are, and they have seen so much more than we have, and they will continue to show much more. They will continue to witness, I would say that's a better term, witness more than we will ever witness in our lifetimes. And so the wisdom and knowledge embedded into these stones, for me, is profound. And as Indigenous peoples, we understand that everything has life to it. And so I have it in recognition, you know, of the basic concept of the exhibition. I literally took stones, placed them in nets, and suspended them from the infrastructure of the gallery. And suspending them to acknowledge that separation of sovereignty and sovereign practice from the land and from our people, you know, also knowing, recognizing that we were once more connected to the Aina, but now separated by different degrees over time, you know, over different places. So the reason to put them in these nets is, you know, let's cast our nets out there and feed ourselves with the land, with the Aina, with everything that is a part of that land that serves to nourish us. And we also recognize through the shadows that are cast on the walls in back are the ancestors, you know, that have come before us, and always recognizing who we are because of them, and recognizing their presence in the space itself. The other aspect of the nets too is that I think we can go to the next slide. The other aspect of the nets is that you know, they also can be a double-edged sword. You know, our we can look at, yes, we are casting the net and nourishing ourselves with the spirit and the knowledge and the wisdom of the land, or we can be captured in the net that we create for ourselves. And so this is, you know, an expression, you know, of that, you know, we have a choice to make, and those choices that we make impact others, impact this place in which we live and celebrate. I wouldn't want to live anywhere else in the world, Hawaii. And And, you know, we honor our ancestors, we honor our present day people, and of course, you know, the generations to come, come after us. So that is a little bit about, you know, the foundation of this particular piece. Mahalo.
Aloha. So this is a gallery view. And I think what's really important is that what the curators did was really place the works based on relationships. And I won't go into that, so they can go into that. But maybe next slide. So this piece is called Eho'o Kanaka. What it is, how can I say it? So it's actually a saying that was said from Kamehameha Paiea to his son Liholiho on his deathbed. And the way the process that I did it was, in 2019, I did an installation called Au'a, which was dedicated to Haunani K. Trask, that used the words, "We are not American," and also her voice. I went to Hawaiian leaders, who I saw as Hawaiian leaders within our community, and I asked them to participate. And I asked them if I could put those words on their face. It was difficult for a lot of these people. And it was interesting to me to see that. So I did go and I was able to get people to do it. And when I was thinking about this is what happened during the pandemic. And what I did was I went to the people that I asked that was in Aua, and I said, can you provide me any sort of like quote or words for Hawaiian leaders who have made an impact on you? And just opened it up to that. Got all different kinds of things. And I guess what made it even more, when Haunani K. Trask passed away in the summer of 2021, it was really thinking about how do we remember her? How do we remember our leaders that have made so much sacrifices for ourselves? And how do we honor them? And so that's kind of what I did. And there's one quote that really spoke to me that someone gave me from Kihei De Silva that say, "We are in a battle of remember versus forget. And we need to remember not to forget." So it's projected images with quotes. I think there's the next one with a quote. Is that correct? Can you go to the next slide? Yeah, so you can see on the the one on the left has a quote. So there's huaka suspended. Huaka are also called velo. A lot of people refer to it when they looked at it as a moon phase, but for me, it's actually a design that can be found on the bottom of a pahu drum. It speaks to ancestors and ancestry and lineage. In 1895, after the overthrow, there was a counter-revolution that not many people know about on the slopes of Leahi, where there was over 300 what were called Koa Aloha'aina, who fought to restore and put Queen Liliuokalani back to her throne. They were unsuccessful, but there was that metaphor of Koa Aloha'aina. And then with the recent happenings on Mauna Kea with the TMT building, there were many people who stood for it, specifically the Kupuna who blocked the road and were arrested. And they were also referred to as Koa Aloha'aina. So Koa is a tree. It also symbolizes warrior. And what I did was I was on Mauna Loa. Mauna Loa recently was erupting, and I got the shape of a koa leaf, and that's kind of what that shape is. So if you look, usually koa leaves at other places, not on Mauna Loa, they look kind of like that, really thin. So in putting that, including in the installation, you know, and this is a first iteration because I really don't think it's finished. I have a lot more work to do. The succession of lines of the huaka or velo resemble all of those ʻŌiwi leaders or koa aloha aina that we're honoring. And at one point in time, when I finish it, you know, I hope to put all of those names on the on those cutouts. And what it will do is it'll not only list the leaders, but also the people who gave me the quotes as future leaders. And so it'd be a lineage of, you know, it could be familiar, like your ancestry, but also it could be based on who your kumu is, which is kind of interesting in developing a new kind of mo'oku auhau or genealogy. The image on the right is called Battle Fatigue. It was done after going to a WIPC conference in Toronto in 2017. And there was a lecture talking about the battle fatigue that we as educators have to face every day. And it was like, you know, it's kind of a given that when you work with non-Native people in education, it's sort of a given that there's going to be conflict. But the question is, what happens when the conflict happens from someone of your own? Yeah, so that's it. Mahalo.
Mahalo for sharing Kapulani and Kaili. Just to pick up Kapulani, something that you just shared about presenting an iteration or an early iteration of a work that is still in progress. I feel like that's not something that as curators we often experience when making an exhibition, and also as artists, something that we often put forward when participating in an exhibition. But I learned a lot from you wanting to show this work in progress or this early iteration of a work that remains to be completed. I think there's a different kind of vulnerability in showing quote unquote unfinished work in an exhibition, and a different way of incorporating the feedback that comes through conversations into the future iterations. So I just wanted to share that, something that I learned from the piece that you contributed to ʻŌiwi. And then Kaili, to go back to what you shared about containment, I think a lot about other bodies of work that you continue to develop, specifically Veritas. So your welded steel cells that are sometimes locked on the outside or the inside or unlocked, and just kind of trying to draw a connection between that series and the work that is in ʻŌiwi, I think is also meaningful for audiences, in the sense that it is a part of a much larger process of you sort of working through those notions of containment as they relate to our people, to our culture here in Hawaii. Josh and Noel, do you folks wanna comment on Kapua Kaili's work or?
Yeah, so I do want to point out that this is the only large painted surface in an otherwise white box. This is something Drew can speak to much more than I, but the importance of the presence of Po, that darkness of creativity, of cosmos, of depths of sea, was really critical, I think, to the way in which both Kapu's piece is presented, as well as Piikea's on the other, which is the other side of this darkened wall. And it really grounds the space, and to have not had that would have been to be trapped in the white imperial colonial box that we continue to find ourselves in too often. And so we don't need to get into the weeds about it, but I just want to say that maybe Drew, if you just want to say a little bit, just something as small but critically important becomes an issue. And I think it's worth a mention.
For sure. Maybe in a sentence, Piikea just jumped on. But in a sentence, when someone misunderstands a decision as an aesthetic choice and not a, a choice that's rooted in culture, we have issues. And we had many instances when we were making this exhibition of the gallery director, the current gallery director, Michael Paula, misunderstanding cultural decisions for aesthetic ones. And this wall and other walls, which we were not allowed to paint, became a part of a larger conversation around sort of lack of support. So this ended up being the only wall that we were allowed to paint in the space. And because we were only allowed to paint one wall, as Noelle said, we wanted to embrace the sort of potentiality of Blackness, of beginnings, of pull. So, you know, long story short, I think making exhibitions in westernized institutional settings come with a lot of obstacles, and maybe it becomes about how we navigate with skill and with wit so that we are able to do the work that we want to do in places that want to make it really difficult for us to do that work. I see the message from Piikea. Oh, I see your face. Aloha, Piikea. Thanks for joining us. Since you're here, do you want to speak a little bit about your work? You want to share a little bit about Makavalu?
Oh gosh, I didn't mean to break in. I just wanted to listen in to. I'll have a chance to talk about it later. Well, yeah, whatever. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah,
no worries. Heidi, can we go back a few slides?
Aloha, Noelle.
A few more.
Josh, Kaili, aloha.
One more, or before Kahi's. One more. There we go. So the work in yellows and reds in the grid on the back wall is Piikea's piece titled Makavalu. Thanks for sharing a bit about it, Piikea.
Yeah, thank you. Aloha, Kako. Makavalu is it's a word I've been really drawn to over the last few years. Makavalu, a literal translation, it means eight eyes. And the kauna within that word are many, many, many different layers of meaning in that. Amongst them is describing the capacity to see in multiple layers, multiple capacities, multiple perspectives. Something that I think has been a talent or a particular principle or capability that I think our all colonized people have had to hone in the generations of occupation. Makavalu also has a couple of other meanings, one of which is a battle formation. and it involves a triangular positioning of bodies. I like the layered aspects of meaning and being able to layer imaging pattern. I like the fact that I can, you know, play around with the arrangement of that, and it, you know, has its own, you can change it around and, you know, pull things upside down and just move things around, and it still reads, and it still it still aligns to the idea of Makavalu. So yeah, that's you know, basically what it is. First time I've worked in a particular medium, or media, it's metal. metal plates and then traditionally printed. So I leave it at that. Drew, so yeah, thank you very much. It's a great honor to be able to be in the exhibition, but also to be able to share that wall and to be in the midst of that wall, knowing that it was the only, you know, learning, coming to know that it was the only wall that was permitted to reference Paul. So it's, you know, it's a great honor to be able to be on that space. Yeah.
Mahalo for sharing that, Pika.
Hi.
Just to give a little more detail on the work, it's one of the few pieces in the exhibition that was printed within or made within the department. And yeah. So Pika collaborated with a longtime friend, printmaking professor Charlie Cohen, to help print those metal plates that were themselves sourced from an earlier installation of Pika's called Po'ole in the Hawai'i Triennial 2022. Mm-hmm. And so I guess I just share that because the work also feels important to me because it demonstrates a relationship between a participating artist and a current professor within the department that is about supporting that artist's practice, not about excluding them from the environment of learning. And that's one of the rare instances in the exhibition where that happens, but it feels worth, it feels important to acknowledge it because of that.
What a shame.
It's 10:20. I believe we're here for another 30 or 40 minutes. Is that correct, Heidi?
Yeah, that's correct. But I know you have like a couple more slides or at the end. Did you still want to go ahead and share that?
Yeah, we can go through the slides and then also hopefully open up to kind of more unstructured conversation with the group. We can do a send off for Kalanana Po at the end of the talk. We just listen for maybe the last five minutes of the talk.
Okay, cool. And by the way, for our audience, if you have any questions, feel free to put the questions in the chat and we'll hopefully get around to, you know, sharing all the or addressing all the questions. But just for some clarity, Drew, you want to save this for later, yeah?
Yes, we can all listen together maybe 5-10 minutes before the hour.
Okay, well, mahalo to everyone for, you know, sharing, giving us some insight on this exhibition. I myself had come up with a few questions, if you don't mind me just kind of kicking off the conversation. And by all means, anyone that wants to participate, feel free. One of the questions that I had was, you know, looking at sort of the relational experience of the exhibition and the intentional lack of labels. Can you talk a little bit about sort of the thought process behind that and, you know, what that looks like?
Maybe we can all provide our different perspectives on the inclusion of wall labels or not. But before we do, I just want to also add that there is an exhibition takeaway that has a floor plan with all the corresponding information on the artist, the artwork title, the materials, and the date. So the information is there. It's just not presented in the form of a label. And for me, that has to do with insisting on a right to opacity. We know the work that has been made. We know who it was made by. People that are a part of the contemporary Hawaiian art movement know the stories of these works and the artists that made them without labels. those who aren't a part of the community or who haven't been likely do not know the names of the makers or the communities that they're a part of. And so in that sense, I think that decision to displace that information, explanatory information from a wall to a printed takeaway is about acknowledging a certain audience before another. And for me, that audience is the artists and it's the communities that they're a part of. And, you know, just personally, that's who I make exhibitions for. That's who I want to be in conversation with. And, you know, it can be, I think, off-putting for some to come in and not see that kind of information given easily on a wall. But it forces us to develop or have a different kind of relationship to the work, one that isn't about a name, a date, materials, or a title, but it's really about standing there in front of or alongside or behind something and experiencing it in that moment. I'll stop there. Noelle has other opinions, as does Josh.
Maybe I just add is, yeah, as you said, the information's not absent from the space. The guide provides a sort of roadmap through the gallery. But I think what the kind of also lack of labels does is, I think, put a little more work on those viewing the exhibition, the audience. And I think it also really opens up the opportunity for conversation around the work. If you don't know, you can ask. And the curators are very much present in the space. And so I think it does kind of drive dialogue and exchange and opens it up, not just for us to talk about what the work is about, but also for audiences to reflect and enter into conversation. So yeah, Noelle.
So I will confess that I am, that I have seen this absence of labels work. So I'm a label geek. The first thing I do is read a label. So, but what I have done and what I have seen and what I have felt is to sit in the living room around artwork without labels is to imagine ourselves living with this kind of work. And one of the things, and I'll say that this is what has been a profound disappointment, and I've heard Imai Kalani Kalahele say this as well as Rocky Jensen, is that they're less interested in encouraging appreciation of Hawaiian art by non-Hawaiians as it is about getting our own people to appreciate our own artists and the work that they do. And so, you know, even for a moment to sit in the living room and be surrounded by these wondrous things, right? Is to imagine, why not? Why shouldn't all of us be living with this work? Why should this artwork be rolled up in a garbage bag for 20 years or be leaning in somebody's garage? You know what I mean? It's like, how do we get to this place where we appreciate our own artists and the work that they continue to do in the absence of recognition, not just by institutions, but by our own community? If that's the one thing that I think we take away from this, is not that this is an institutional intervention per se, while it is, but also that all of a sudden, you know, we're sort of spurring a new appreciation within our own community for the work that these profoundly important artists are doing.
Mahalo everyone for your insight on the labels. I also have a question just about, like, you know, I think you sort of addressed it in one way, Noelle, about you know, who does this serve? Like, who is the audience? And on one hand, of course, there's this very like institutional sort of call out, if you will, and a very necessary intervention. On the other hand, it's also, you know, as you mentioned, Noelle, like generating this type of like awareness and sort of pridefulness and support among other Native Hawaiians for Native Hawaiian artists and art. So I guess if you could just share a little bit, I know the exhibition isn't that old, but if there, I'm curious to know, like, if there's been any pushback or if there's been any additional conversations that have been that have come to the fore as a result of this exhibition. And maybe if you could sort of maybe talk a little bit about, you know, how, what those dynamics might look like.
Lots of conversations, some affirming and others important reminders of the work that remains to be done, for sure. Yesterday, I think before we gave a tour, Kaili, you were there, the current department chair kind of informed us that they were beginning to develop a position for a focus within the studio art program for a Hawaiian artist and for a kind of Hawaiian studio art practice. And then in the same breath, informed us that the process would take 2 years minimum. So I think there's this sort of this embrace of bureaucracy within the system as a kind of shield or a way to defer responsibility, because it hasn't, you know, it's not going to take 2 years. It's taken, as Kaili said, 75 years. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there is, I think, to get back to your question, there is pushback from certain folks, but I think what they're doing is just demonstrating the kind of racism that is embedded in their positions and in the department. And so in that sense, it often tells us more about where they're at than I think where we're at.
And Drew, you know, I just like to, let everyone here know that the University of Hawaii system has been mandated to create a place of Hawaiian learning. How do you do that without any Hawaiians? Of course, you know. So again, you know, to come back to those who are falsely identifying, you know, as Hawaiian, I think that's extremely problematic. It just drives me crazy that we continue to have to deal with that kind of racism, where someone is, you know, stealing our identity, so to speak. So
another thought to this too is that a few years ago, I think maybe it was 21, it was a student-led effort, and they created a manifesto basically about the need to decolonize the art department, the art and art history department. So there is this context for at least student awareness of some of the severely problematic issues within the department. But I would return to this conversation around decolonization versus indigenization, where in decolonization, you're sort of still centering it on the colonial, on the failed colonial project. It is constantly responding to the system and the obstacles the racism, right? But at the same time, as Drew and others have said, this issue of affirmation versus resistance, that when you indigenize a space, you're centering Hawaiian ideas, you know, the visual aesthetics, the ano, the sense of place and being. And that to me is what is what I see this exhibition as representing, that it is more than an argument, you know, against decolonization or for decolonization. It's a takeover. It's a little mini for the time, you know, but I mean, it's like, it's a weird, right? Oh, you're permitting us to take over for, yeah. Yeah, anyway, but I think it's brilliant. It's been an honor to be able to work with Drew and Josh. This is the first time that the three of us have collaborated together in this way. And I have learned so much about the ways in which this generation navigates and pushes and expands boundaries, and is so respectful and grounded about the historical context and the way in which all the artists represented, you know, have been doing this work. So I'm just grateful for the learning experience that this has been for me.
Actually, that kind of like segues into another question I had about, you know, how this relationship developed between the curators, Noelle, Drew, and Josh, and how this, you know, how this entire project came to fruition. I know that there's like a initial relationship with UH, and, you know, you have your relationship with the community, but, you know, also the breadth of work that's involved, right? So like 40 artists is plenty of artists, it's so much. And so what determined, you know, that specific number, and, you know, maybe what was the timeline and how did this initial sort of partnership evolve?
Where to begin? I mean, I'll just say that the three of us have worked together in different capacities for, I would say, the last 8 or 9 years. I returned to Hawaii in 2014 after spending time away doing education and going to school, and upon moving home, that's kind of when I first reconnected with Drew, and soon later began working for his mother, Maile Meyer, who is a longtime advocate for Native Hawaiian artists, and really support system. And so, yeah, and I think it was Drew and Maile had co-founded an exhibition series called Contact, which looked at this notion of contact as it relates to the Hawaiian Islands. And then that's when I became connected to Noelle, as Noelle was our curator for Contact in 2015. And since then we've kind of had lots of overlappings and intersections, and I'm so grateful as well to be working and learning from both of you. But ʻŌiwi really kind of kicked off a few years ago, just through a series of conversations with Drew and with Noelle about this need, for a large scale exhibition. I guess I can just add, like, I mean, our sort of like our pathway to this point has really been just guided by conversation and relationships. We had originally kind of envisioned the project in a very different way. Well, not in a very different way. I should just say, like, maybe one example is this kind of like main central exhibition at UH. We had originally planned to kind of honor kind of our most senior Hawaiian artists in this space, and then have all the other exhibitions kind of orbit around this central exhibition. But through conversations with some of the senior artists, one in particular who was like, oh, why would I want to just show art with all the old guys? Like, I want to show art with the young people. And so that really just immediately sent us on a different direction, where we realized that this exhibition has to be intergenerational. It has to honor the relationships of mentors and mentees. I think just one example of many that really kind of shows how this exhibition has really been guided by relationships and conversation. So I don't know if Drew or Noelle, you want to add anything else?
I'll just add a bit about the importance of doing things together. In the arts, we're often encouraged to take a more individualistic approach to what we do, right? It's always about our name being associated with the work that we make, at least within the schools that I had to pass through. But really, I think the most important aspect of anything is being a part of community, or being a part of a group that is working towards a shared goal. So in that sense, I think the work that we're doing in making this exhibition is also an important reminder for Hawaiian artists and for Hawaiian curators that it's better to do things together than to do things alone. Especially if you're trying to move something in a small but meaningful way. And so co-curating, I think that should just become the norm. I think making or collaborating on a work of art that has many authors, or writing something together, or co-teaching a class, I'm really interested in those kinds of approaches to art education and curating that decenter the individual and recenter on community.
I'll just jump in here and say, you know, I think that initially we came together in the writing of the first grant, right, which was funded by the Institute of Museum and Library Services, the Native American, Native Hawaiian grant, which I'll just say, it's not enough. You know what I mean? That this amount that they're putting out, it's really not enough to do substantial and important work. And what happens is you've got to then cobble together from multiple sources the funding necessary to put something together like this. And one of the things I saw was that with this, the Native American Culture and Arts Foundation, and that was a shift, right? Was it a shift? It was a shift grant.
Oh, for that, NACF.
Yeah. Yes. But the fact that I don't think that they had ever seen somebody come in as a collaborative curatorial proposal. Right, it's usually an individual artist or a collective of artists, but not a collective curatorial project. So I even think just the freedom or the ability to think outside of the box in the ways in which something can happen, and understand and not being afraid to ask for more. Right, we're just so often getting by with just the little. So I also appreciate this awareness that no way, it needs to be this. We need to provide artists with money, commissioning new work, like all of that. I think was critical to the ultimate pulling off the magnitude of the project, because I think we start now and then it's like, how many more venues? Oh, here's a new venue opening at Leeward Community College. Let's throw that into the mix. So just it kind of constantly, it's almost like grew of its own accord.
Just to add really quickly to that, Noelle, I think we need more artists that are making exhibitions. Yeah. I call myself a curator, but I'm an artist. And I think when artists make exhibitions, We often do so for a reason, and that reason for me is because nobody else is supporting the work that, as an artist, I believe should be supported. And in this context, that's contemporary Hawaiian art. So, you know, if we're just going to wait around for some curator to come ask us to be in a show that they don't really understand, what's the point? I think we need more artists organizing exhibitions of their friends' work, of their family's work, of their larger community's work.
I just want to add one more thing, is that, like, just to talk about the lack of support from UH. We also did not receive any funding from the University of Hawaii for any of these exhibitions, aside from one Admiral residency grant, or two, sorry, actually, which will then bring Piikea home to do workshops with students, as well as my Ka'i tubs. But we did raise all of these funds independently of the UH system. And often we're actually told that the funds we raised were not enough to do what we wanted to do.
And we provided all the labor, we covered all the material costs, we do all the installation ourselves, we do the lighting, we print all the takeaways, and still are told we're not doing enough.
And you're also told what you can and cannot do. And you also provide babysitting services for the director of the gallery.
Oh, all the tea is being spilled.
This is ridiculous.
So I do see there's a question here. Someone was asking about the yellow plinth, the winding yellow plinth. You guys want to say a little thing about that?
Yeah. There are lots of ways, I think, to approach that, the plinth, but also the question that is asked about it. Maybe I will just respond by saying I really am drawn to the idea of sharing space, of sharing a display. And so that plinth is a way for us to allow participating artists to share a platform. And in sort of bringing in the yellow, we're kind of trying to get around the current gallery director's refusal of our request to paint the walls. So we're bringing in color that has cultural significance in the ways that we can. And the surface of that plinth was one of those ways. We also left the sides raw, which is not something that I have often experienced in a university gallery or museum environment. Usually the plinths are painted white, but I think it's important to kind of let that material show itself. Another layer to the plinths is that they are adapted from a previous installation. So within the plinths, there's a smaller plinth that we've built that's the shell around and raised about 30 inches. And that's just a practical, the practical consideration of not having the resources to build new plinths. So using pre-existing plinths and adapting them to our needs. But it also is meaningful to us because the earlier plinths held the work of the Pacific Sisters, who we really have a lot of love for. So in that way, it also is connecting this exhibition to a previous one materially. Josh or Noel, if you want to add anything.
I love that you shared that.
It also changed shape. There's a couple, it started out being more of a Hoaka shape, and then shifted, and then became more of Kunani said, he thought it looked like an umbilical cord. Yeah, so I think it's just that flexibility, it became what was necessary in the space that it holds. Hmm. Are there any other questions that anybody else?
Yeah.
Heidi.
Oh. I have another question from Rachel, the director at the Co is asking, and I think this is a maybe timely after, you know, talking about a lack of funding and support and resources. We're curious to know, like, what comes next? How do you all envision moving forward? And where does this project take us? And on that note, I'd also like to add, if there are ways that we can support the work that you all are doing, you know, please feel free to let us know. And but yeah, if you'd like to maybe address what the next steps are on this project.
Drew, do you want to talk about the publication?
Yeah, sure. So in parallel to the exhibition making, we're also collaborating on publication. And Ian asked about this earlier. It's a two-part publication, which, you know, may become a one-part publication, depending on capacity by the end of this project. But the first part is sort of intended to serve as a source book. So to gather articles written about exhibitions of contemporary Hawaiian art over the past 40-ish years, make a selection from those articles, to gather installation images that document the past exhibitions discussed in those articles, writings from artists, reprinted essays by some folks in the room, including Karen Kosasa and P.E.K. Clark. And Noelle and Josh. What else? Texts on artists. And then the second part of the publication will be more focused on ʻŌiwi itself. So on the stakes of the exhibition, the artists that were participating, there'll be write-ups on all the artists, and there'll be artwork details and installation images of the six venue exhibition as it unfolds between now and August of this year. I think in the most immediate sense, we have to make four more exhibitions in 4 months. So that's sort of where our focus is right now, trying to do what we can in spaces that are not as hospitable as they could be.
I think for us, one of the things that we've been discussing is really the need to have our own Indigenous Hawaiian collection, to either ask the State Foundation of Culture and the Arts for loans, to ask the artists for their own work, in part because, like I said, it's gathering dust in a garage somewhere, or friends who bought or acquired work from other friends, and those that forms the core of the collections that we're pulling from. But I think, you know, and especially Josh and I recently were at an IMLS meeting and hearing so many tribal museums talking about their projects, and the fact that we in Hawaii do not have our own museum or our own place to collect that which represents us as defined by us, right? So I think the idea of trying to start to form a core collection of Indigenous art is something that I would love to see be an outgrowth or out from my.
So if you don't mind, I'll jump in. I have my hand raised, but my brown hand fades. You know, I have to say it at a distance, all of this is a bit dumbfounding. You know, first, the 70-year thing is like, you know, how can that be, right? And then 20 years since the last exhibition. So when I heard of this exhibition, you know, the first thing that came to mind was, you know, institutional critique. And it's so different because usually you know, it's one person. So it's an individual who does the work against the Goliath. But, you know, Noelle mentioned it earlier, like this is an interesting situation in that this is a sanctioned institutional critique somehow. So I'm curious about a couple of things. You know, when we were talking before we went live, you know, I mentioned that I felt like this was such an urgent situation, but I mean, it sounds like it's been urgent for 70 years or whatever, 100 years, 100. The question has to do with, you know, like, why now? Like, why has it taken 20 years? Why is this the moment? Like, there's so much strategy behind this, and I see that it's been calculated over a couple of years. So I'm just wondering about that, the strategy of mounting a whole exhibition, how it was allowed into the institution. I mean, it's obviously a pretty fraught situation, and continues to be. So if you could just like elaborate a little bit on the strategy of bringing in a whole show that will travel throughout the whole system. I mean, it's just like, it's an amazing, you know, Trojan horse you bring in into all of these spaces. And I'm just wondering, you know, about the timing and the strategy of allowing the university to bring you in.
I mean, in a sentence, I don't think they understood what they were saying yes to. But we knew what they were saying yes to. And maybe I'd also just add, I had the privilege to work with Kapu and Kaili on an exhibition called Mai Ho'ohuli Kalimai Luna. And that was maybe 2 years ago in the middle of the pandemic. And we did an assessment of the Hawaii State Foundation on Culture and the Arts collection and determined that less than 3% of their holdings were artworks made by Kanaka artists, despite accounting for over 20% of the population. So that exhibition really, I think, began a larger process of kind of holding a mirror up to these institutions that are often asking us to support them for whatever reason, and asking them to think critically about the decisions that they have made over the years and what their commitments are to Hawaiians today. And so, you know, out of my ho'ohuli came the Hawai'i Triennial, which also offered a certain criticism of the state within a state museum. It focused on Native and non-Native collaborations against U.S. Empire in Hawaii and was presented at the State Art Museum. And out of that came Pōhaku, which, you know, as we've made clear, is doing what it's doing within the university system. And maybe next will be Honolulu Museum of Art, which has not organized an exhibition like this for over 20 years either. But, you know, in terms of how to smuggle something in, I think it really just comes down to the folks that are in the right positions, supporting other folks in different positions and kind of unifying our efforts across the system through the community colleges and then into the main campus. I think that's what it's all about. And so, you know, maybe Kapu, you want to talk a little bit more about this. I'm only at Kapulani Community College because of Kapu. And so I think, you know, there are lots of situations like that across the system. And because we are all working towards the same goal, we're able to, yeah, to infiltrate and to affirm in different ways than we may have been able to over the past few decades. It feels like a kind of critical moment right now from my young perspective. But Kapu, you've been in it for a long time, and Karen, you have too. maybe you folks have other perspectives you want to share.
Karen, how about you do it? You've been here longer.
My dear friend, Karen, you've been called out.
Yeah, I'm actually dumbfounded too, right? And I'm in the system. And so, yeah, I just think it is amazing, as Drew has said, that he doesn't think the institution realized what it was getting into, right? Because they're grateful then that someone is, you know, a group, you know, a collaborative curatorial team is coming in to give them this show, to provide them this show, so they can say, see, we are supportive in some ways, right? But at the same time, yeah, I think that they had no idea that this was going to be about a critique too. And so that's part of the difficult conversation that is starting. I don't know if you guys want to say a little bit more about that, because I just think that we're going to learn so many things from this. I'm totally dumbfounded and appreciate being, you know, just supporting on the sidelines. I have tremendous respect for the artists and their resilience and the fact that, you know, that they can't afford to not go forward and push things. But yeah, this really just shows you how institutional racism and structural inequality is profoundly deep. And among people, you know, we all consider ourselves to be very sensitive and liberal, but it's right there in our very, you know, our home. But do you guys, Noelle, Drew, Josh, if you could speak about the conversation that's starting a little bit, maybe?
Yeah,
the uncomfortable part.
I do just want to say, though, that in writing the IMLS grant, which was the first one, it required us to say that the University of Hawaii was agreeing to this, right? You can't propose something if the partner is not amenable. So MICA did write a letter of support and commitment for the project. And in doing so, like this is what she wrote, it has been 2 decades since the UH Manoa Art Gallery presented Maina Kupuna Mai Ho'i Kapuola. I look forward to building on this precedent by participating in the realization of this urgent application in support of contemporary Native Hawaiian artists and art. So I think that she was keenly aware of the context within which why it becomes important. But I do think it's accurate to say that the critique, the intro text, did take the department by surprise, which is surprising in and of itself, that they could not have foreseen or anticipated such a critique, or maybe they thought it was, you know, a kinder, gentler version of, and so that intro text spawned conversation within the faculty, like what have we gotten ourselves into, right? And some faculty were like, bring it on, they're excited, they've used this as an opportunity to engage with their students and encourage their students to tell them to write to your department chair, write to your faculty, make what you want known. Because part of it is this idea that students actually have a lot of power within the university system. They're just told they don't. And so this too is this moment in time when we think, why now? Actually, students are more empowered in a way than almost any other time that I've seen in recent memory within the university system. So I just think there's some alignment that's happening that hopefully will propel transformation of the department forward. But Kapulani is very skeptical, so just
Well, I think we're just about at time. And so I want to, if there are any other like closing comments or questions, I'm happy to do that. But otherwise, we can share that clip that you had ready to go. Any closing comments from the panelists?
I want to express gratitude. Mahalo for inviting us to share a bit about the work that we're doing here in Hawai'i. It's wonderful to have a chance to speak with Noelle, Josh, Kaili, and Kapu. And I really appreciate everybody's comments from the group and your folks' willingness to listen and share openly. So, mahalo.
Mahalo.
Yeah. Thank you. And likewise, we're incredibly grateful for your time and, you know, all of the work that you all are doing back home. So mahalo for being here with us and for sharing your work with a broader audience. And for all of those that have come to participate in this discussion, we thank you. The Coe Art Center will make this video or recording available on their YouTube channel. And I'm sure that they will also share that on their socials. So please just keep an eye out for that. We just want to mention one quick thing, which is that the Coe Center also hosts a couple of community-based events. We have our First Friday, which occurs at the first Friday of every month. And it's essentially an opportunity for everyone in the community to stop by and participate in tours. We also have a newsletter that we welcome you to subscribe to. I'll add a link into the chat. And also, of course, thank you to Mario for helping organize this event and for all the artists involved. And so mahalo nui. Thank you, everyone.
And I'll just say thank you.
Oh, sorry, Mario.
Sorry, just one quick thank you to the group, again, for your agility, but also for trusting us to have this conversation in this way. So I appreciate that as well. Thank you so much.
Oh, 国を上げ上げ国は何